We have our ritual. You have to see it, our video before starting. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Professor Glenn Most. Good morning, Professor Ettore Cingano. Today we have the privilege to have two hosts here, Professor Glenn Most's lecture, and in a while Professor Cingano will introduce him. And by coincidence, today, maybe you have seen it in the Repubblica, there was an article on Confucius in the Agora of Athens, and to celebrate the anniversary, the year of culture and tourism between Greece and China. And Vice Rector Caterina Carpinato wrote this article. So I invite you to read it because it is a wonderful coincidence. And this article celebrates the dialogue between these two ancient civilizations as a symbol of friendship between the two countries. And so it is with great honor and pleasure that today we will host Glenn's lecture. What brings Glenn to Venice here today? First of all, his excellent scholarship in Greek classical tradition, and then his curiosity toward other classical tradition and especially Chinese civilization and ancient civilization. Glenn has been in China several times, so we have common friends as well. So I hope that this can be the beginning of a constant dialogue among civilizations, among all civilizations. As you know, Venice is famous for language and culture of all over the world. So this might be the beginning of a new era where we study civilizations in comparison. Thank you so much for being with us. And I give the floor to Professor Cingano. Grazie, Willy.
Thank you, Tiziana. Good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure and an honor to welcome here at Ca' Foscari Professor Glenn Most, a colleague and a friend for nearly 40 years. Although being a pleasure, this short introduction is also quite a task, given Glenn Most's stature and status as a scholar. I shall start by saying that he embodies, in the fullest sense of the word, the perfect image of a man of learning and a man of the world. He studied classics at Harvard, where he received a BA in Latin, and then studied comparative literature at Yale University and received a PhD there under the guidance of Paul de Man. In those years, however, he also studied classics at the University of Tübingen in Germany and took a PhD under Richard Kannicht with a thesis on Pindar. In 1980, he was appointed assistant professor of classics at Princeton University, where he stayed for 5 years, and then moved on in Italy to at the University of Siena. At the same time, he was visiting professor at the University of Michigan. In 1987, he was appointed professor of Klassische Philologie, classical philology, in Austria at the University of Innsbruck, and later on, he moved to Germany and became full professor at the University of Heidelberg, where he taught until 2001. In those years, Most was also professor at the Committee on Social Thought, and still is, at the University of Chicago. From 2001 until last year, Glenn Most has been professor of Philologia Greca at the Scuola Normale di Pisa, and remains a regular visiting professor in Chicago, and also an external member of the Max Planck Institute for the History of Science in Berlin. In some ways, his academic journey equates him to a clericus vagans of the past, yet on a global scale and with a far stronger, relentless intellectual drive and energy. I dare say, although he might disagree, that his stay at Yale proved seminal in honing his interest for comparative studies. As a matter of fact, he first co-edited the book on The Poetics of Murder, Detective Fiction and Literary Theory in 1983, and has published other papers on the subject. On the other hand, his years in Tübingen in Germany probably rooted him in German philological and philosophical thought and helped him to develop a keen interest in the concept of Altertumswissenschaft, sciences of antiquity, of Geistgeschichte, and in the related problems of hermeneutics, transmission and reception of texts. I would say that key figures, as friends and as scholars he collaborated with in many significant books, are the eminent Princeton historian Anthony Grafton and Andre Lux, professor of ancient philosophy, now in Mexico. When confronted with his vast output of books and papers, one experiences a sense of dizziness, all the more so since, apart from being written in many languages, many of them are translated in various modern languages, a rarity which hardly applies to a classicist, let alone a philologist. His work encompasses such a wide range of authors, as we shall see, of subjects, fields, and theories, that Professor's most intellectual personality could easily be split into three or four different identities. As a matter of fact, in 1994, he was the first classicist to receive the Leibniz Preis of the Deutsche Forschungsgemeinschaft. I must then be extremely selective. In the field of Greek literature, I shall quote his book on Pindar, The Measures of Praise, which came out in 1985. And the edition of Theophrast's Metaphysique with André Lax, which came out at the Belles Lettres in France in 1993, as well as the critical edition translation in two volumes for the Loeb Classical Library of Hesiod and a Hesiodic Corpus, all the poems and fragments attributed to Hesiod, which has a second edition recently, 2018. And the monumental edition in 9 volumes with translation and notes in co-edition with André Lax again of the fragments of early Greek philosophy, a thorough remake, utter revision and updating of the epoch-making fragmented for Socratica edited by Diels and Kranz at the beginning of the last century, with intention to present to the larger public the information we possess concerning early Greek philosophy. Other books co-edited with André Lax are studies on the Derveni papyrus, a fascinating text, and also the oldest literary papyrus ever found, which is a philosophical treatise with an allegorical commentary on an Orphic poem and recently, with André Lax, Les débuts de la philosophie grecque. For Glenn Most, classical studies are a field and an intellectual experience which only acquires its full meaning and value if placed in a larger context by way of comparison with other civilizations. He has therefore explored in a number of large collaborative projects with junior and senior scholars the historical and theoretical aspects of various scholarly practices which have played a role in the study of ancient Greece and Rome, practices such as editing texts, commenting upon them, establishing the canon of authors, and so on. A series of 5 volumes was edited by him at the turn of the century, collecting fragments, editing texts, commentaries, historicization, disciplining classics, and with Anthony Grafton and Salvatore Settis, he has also edited later on the monumental volume on the classical tradition, a very useful encyclopedia of what the classical tradition is all about, with the entries about papyrology and all that. Another recent co-edition with Grafton is Post-Classicism. In the field of history of classical scholarship and the practice of editing texts, he has edited and translated to seminal works from a distant and recent past, such as Friedrich Wolff's Prolegomena to Homer with Anthony Grafton and James Zetzel, and Sebastiano Timpanaro's The Genesis of Lachmann's Method, which was written in 1963, whereas Wolff's Prolegomena date from 1795. Another book co-edited with Grafton in 2016 is Canonical Texts and Scholarly Practices, a Global Comparative Approach, with a chapter on collation and commentary in the Neo-Confucian tradition in 12th century China. Interestingly, for today's talk, the cover of the book shows a piece of Chinese pottery recovered from a tomb in the Hunan province, and the statuette on the pottery depicts 2 kneeling clerks checking the accuracy of manuscripts, therefore busy in collating. A recent book, which I haven't seen, I must say, written and co-edited with Kevin Chung and Tony Grafton, is on impagination, layout and materiality of writing and publication, interdisciplinary approaches from East and West. Finally, a different field is represented by his interest in the history of art, where transmission, reception, and interpretation of antiquity in modern times is a central issue. First book is translated in Italian as Leggere Raffaello, La Scuola di Atene e il suo pretesto, which came out at Einaudi in 2001, where Glenn Most argues that the model of Raphael's painting the School of Athens was a passage in Plato's Protagoras. A second book, which was a great success, translated also in Chinese, was Doubting Thomas, translated in Italian as Il Dito nella Piaga, Le storie di Tommaso l'Incredulo, in Audi 2009, where he provides a sensitive reading of the Gospel of John and how the touching of the wound was understood by interpreters throughout the history of reception, including the paintings related to the biblical stories, such as Caravaggio's Doubting Thomas. Besides countless articles in periodicals, books, and so on Greek and Latin authors on Shakespeare, he has co-edited a book with Susanna Brown, I found very interesting, on ancient anger, perspectives from Homer to Galen, and a book on Kafka he co-edited recently, Wunsch, Indianer zu werden, Versuche über einen Satz von Franz Kafka. Glenn Most is no newcomer in Venice. A few years ago, he gave a lecture on sad stories on the death of kings at Venice International University, in the advanced seminar on the ancient Mediterranean, Greece, Rome, and the Near East, I organized with Lucio Milano. And let me remind you, some 15 years ago, I invited Professor Fritz Heiner Müchler from Dresden, who taught later Western classics at Northeast Normal University in Changhong and in Beijing, to give a series of lectures in the same seminar. Today, Glenn Most is going to talk on From Athens to China and Back. A Western student of ancient Greece looks at the Chinese classical tradition. Klein.
I applausi per Willy e per Tiziana sono assolutamente dovuti e meritati. Vediamo poi alla fine della mia conferenza se ci saranno. Ringrazio tantissimo Tiziana dell'invito di venire qua e della sfida che lei mi ha offerta a ragionare insieme con voi su dei problemi di importo vasto che su cui sto riflettendo da un po' di tempo. Ringrazio Willy per questa presentazione così generosa e così accurata. Ringrazio voi di essere qua, nonostante l'assenza di Tiepolo, e ringrazio quelli che seguono in streaming per il loro interesse. A questo punto vi do tutti una buona notizia che alla fine di questa frase smetterò di parlare in italiano, perché il mio italiano non è completamente barbaro, ma sono nato e cresciuto in un altro paese, come avrete sentito, e ho deciso di studiare gli antichi greci perché non potevo offendere le loro orecchie con il mio pronuncio. Spero che... Con questo mi rivolgo a voi nella lingua internazionale della scienza, cioè New Jersey. Until recently, modern Europe and the cultures that derive from it accorded an unquestioned privilege to the classical traditions they knew best, those of ancient Greece and Rome. When I was a student, many serious scholarly books were published that bore in their titles not only the words classical tradition or equivalent expressions, but also the definite article the. Here are two particularly prominent examples. These books were generally produced by prominent scholars who had already proven their merits in the detailed study of ancient Greek and Latin texts. They were filled with information useful for students, treated broad swaths of earlier and later literatures with equal aplomb, and were animated by conspicuous passion for their subject. But as a genre of scholarship, there was something odd about them. Their underlying idea was that there was only one classical tradition worth talking and reading about, the Greco-Roman one. That it was self-evident that when people in the West said classical tradition without further specification, that this was the one they had in mind, since it was the only one that deserved the title, the. The tone of such books was usually celebratory and rather narcissistic. Their Western authors wanted their Western readers to know how lucky they were to have been the beneficiaries of the Western classical tradition. In retrospect, the frequency with which these books were published throughout the 20th century, and especially after the Second World War, may also be interpreted as a warning signal. For why did readers need to be reminded so forcefully and so often of how great a debt they owed this tradition, if not because in the meantime they had started to become forgetful of it? At this point, I must make a confession. As recently as only 10 years ago, I myself, together with two accomplices, perpetrated a book that was published with the very same title. But there were extenuating circumstances. For the classical tradition, the classical tradition, was not the title that we three had chosen ourselves when we conceived our guide to the reception and transformation of ancient Greek and Roman literature, philosophy, art, architecture, fashion, politics, and culture in later Western traditions and throughout the rest of the world. For us, the Greco-Roman classical tradition was the one in which we had grown up and with which we were most familiar. So it was understandable that this was the one to which we could devote ourselves with greatest professional competence. But it was not for us the only classical tradition worth studying. We conceived our book as an invitation to experts on other classical traditions to produce similar guides to their own classical traditions, which could supplement and enlarge the work that we had done. So the title that we wanted for our book was not the classical tradition, but instead a classical tradition, one out of a plurality. Unfortunately, our publisher categorically refused to publish our book under the title that we wanted. Their argument was that if this was only one classical tradition, who would pay good money for a guide to it? People would only buy such a book, they claimed, if this was the classical tradition, not just some classical tradition. Of course, being the publishers, they won the argument, and the book was published under their title. But I did manage to sneak a sentence into the preface indicating what our own preference would have been. Ideally, this guide would have been entitled not the classical tradition, but rather a classical tradition. As it happened, our book sold very well indeed. So perhaps the publishers, who ought to know about such matters, were right after all to insist on the title they preferred. But by the time I was arguing about a title with these publishers, the world that I had known as a student had changed profoundly in all kinds of ways, resulting in enormous upheavals and transformations, both macrocosmic and microcosmic, in the intervening decades. The political and economic hegemony of Western Europe was shattered at the very latest by the Second World War. And in the following decades, it yielded to an internationalization and globalization on an unprecedented scale. An immense increase in the intensity and frequency of interrelations and exchanges among people and goods throughout the world was brought about by new forms of commerce and transportation. And this was accompanied by an acceleration in the development of means of communication that have made information and misinformation easily and immediately accessible to almost every part of the world. A proposito di misinformation, seguite quello che sto dicendo, va bene? Okay, grazie. Despite the continuing resistance to these developments, which is expressed in various forms of localism, nationalism, xenophobia, and fundamentalism, it has become possible in recent years to see far more deeply and broadly into the similarities and differences among widely separated cultures than it ever was before. Inevitably, these prodigious transformations in the large domain of economy and politics have had important transformative effects on the little domain of scholarship as well. As the world has grown more interconnected, not only many ordinary people belonging to different cultural and linguistic traditions, but even some scholars as well, have begun to engage with one another more systematically than ever before. The result is that the possibility has begun to open up for even those who work on the cultures of individual countries or languages, traditionally among the most nationally focused of humanistic scholars, to compare and discuss procedures, objects, and goals in the hope of arriving at a genuinely global concept of their practices. Although this intercultural scholarly dialogue is still in its infancy, it has already made enormous strides in the past few decades, and it can be expected to develop even more strongly in the coming years. Surely, it will lead to a kind of deprovincialization of scholarship, to its becoming ever more comparative and cosmopolitan. Practices and objects that might have seemed natural or self-evident when viewed only within the terms of the culture in which they were produced will inevitably come to look quite different when they are compared to similar and dissimilar practices and objects from different, indeed remote, cultures. These developments have been taking place in different scholarly communities in complementary and corresponding ways. On the one hand, a variety of economic, political, and ideological factors have led many Western scholars to become far more cautious than their predecessors had been about proclaiming the superiority of their own traditions over those of the rest of the world, and have made them much more open to considering the value of other cultures than their own. And on the other hand, the same factors have induced students of a number of non-Western cultures to become not only much more interested in scholarly exchanges of all sorts with the West, but also to study their own domestic traditions with an ever greater degree of sophisticated self-assertion. These larger movements in the depths of international scholarship as a whole could not but have had significant ripple effects on the narrower study of the classics as well. On the one hand, in the West, where the Greek and Roman classics in particular had for centuries formed the core of education and preparation for careers for especially the upper and middle classes, the intense study of these texts has been in a slow and I think apparently irreversible retreat for the past 100 years. Curricula are reformed, positions are canceled, departments are closed, student numbers decrease. I do not in the least expect the Greek and Roman classics to vanish altogether from the schools and universities of Western countries and some other ones, at least during my lifetime. But it would take more optimism than even I can summon to imagine them ever returning to the position of largely unquestioned glory they enjoyed until the 20th century. I presume that in the coming decades, research on the Greek and Roman classics will continue unabated, but that teaching them to students will end up being limited to some schools in some countries and to the larger, wealthier, and more prestigious universities. On the other hand, there has been a remarkable growth of interest in Western classics in a number of non-Western countries over the past years, especially in China. Whether the growth in the East will compensate for the decline in the West, or whether it might even lead to a change in direction in the West, remains to be seen. I myself, as you have heard, am by profession a Western student of ancient Greece, and I too cannot remain indifferent to these manifest and foreseeable developments. They clearly pose a risk to the future of my own studies. But as the great German poet Hölderlin wrote, wo aber Gefahr ist, wächst das Rettende auch. But where there is danger, there grows too that which rescues. Wherever there is a risk, there is also an opportunity. And it seems to me that the present situation, precarious as it is, and precisely because it is so precarious, might well provide a chance for reconceiving the study of classics in general in such a way as to assure and perhaps even strengthen its viability and attractiveness in the years to come. The fundamental criticisms that have been leveled against the Western study of the Greek and Roman classics in the past years and that have tended to accompany, justify, and accelerate their decline have been that their study, and perhaps too the classics themselves that are the object of their study, have acquired an unwarranted and monopolistic social and educational privilege, and that they have been complicit in moral and political ideologies, such as racism, sexism, colonialism, and imperialism, that we must forcefully reject. It seems to me that the best way to answer such criticisms is neither to ignore them, for ignoring them will not make them go away, nor to attempt to refute them, for this argument may be one of the ones that cannot be definitively won, nor to surrender and simply accept them, for I think it would be a pity to decide to throw away the Western classics, but instead to globalize these objections in such a way as to reconceive and thereby to maintain the Western classics with all their glories and all their shadows within the worldwide context of classical traditions in general. I said a moment ago that I myself am by profession a Western student of ancient Greece. And objectively, this is quite true. But subjectively, I have always considered myself to be a generalist or a comparatist who earns his keep by studying ancient Greece in particular, but not exclusively. As a student of literature at university, I had as much difficulty understanding the very idea of studying exclusively a single national literature, be it Greek or Italian or English, as it would have been to study exclusively French mathematics, or Russian physics, or Italian biology. What made literature an object worthy of scientific study was its general nature, as this could be understood by means of comparison, not its various national inflections. So too with regard to the question of the classical tradition, I've always believed that one can understand one classical tradition well only if one sees it in comparison with other classical traditions. The Greco-Roman classical tradition is indeed the one that I myself, like at least some of those present here today, am most familiar with. But that is only because of the accident of our birth. This says nothing about the importance or value of this particular tradition. For during the course of history, and often into the present day, there have been at least about 20 classical traditions scattered throughout the world, from Japan and Korea and Vietnam, through China, Tibet, various Indian languages, Iranian ones, Mesopotamian ones, Turkic, Aramaic, Hebrew, Arabic, Syriac, Egyptian, Coptic, Greek, Latin, Armenian, Ethiopian, Slavonic, all the way to Mayan, to name only these. What all these classical traditions have in common is their focus upon a relatively small group of classical texts, usually preserved in writing, which discuss matters that are taken by the members of some culture to be of supreme importance and permanent validity. Often, scholars who discuss their own classic texts focus upon these texts themselves and try to identify as being inherent within them certain features that justify their being considered classical. For example, intrinsic value, or universal validity, or practical utility. But such discussions tend to be self-congratulatory and self-serving. They make little sense in themselves and are not well suited to conducting a broader intercultural conversation on such matters. Instead, it seems to me more productive to focus less on the classic texts themselves and instead on the classical traditions that are indissolubly linked to the classical texts. For just as there is no classic tradition without a classic text, so too there is no classic text without a classic tradition. Because the classic text is thought by the members of culture to discuss matters of supreme importance and permanent validity, it is consulted frequently over the course of many generations and is used to legitimate long-lasting social, political, and religious institutions. Because that text often remains relatively stable, while the historical context changes and the ordinary language develops, over time it becomes more and more difficult to understand immediately and must be surrounded by specialists like philologists, editors, commentators, school teachers, and examiners who regulate access to it and who are trained, paid, protected, and sometimes punished by institutions that are designed for this very purpose, like schools, libraries, archives, and museums. In each such culture, the classic text and the classical tradition are an interdependent symbiotic pair, a set of cultural Siamese twins that persist through many generations. If we focus not so much on the extraordinary classic texts themselves, admiring them for their incomparable splendor, but instead upon the classical traditions, made up of generations and generations of ordinary little people, scholars and pedants like me, who not only spend their lives caring for those texts, but also may well be thought to have invented them as being classical in the first place, then I believe that we will be in a better position not only to understand the importance of classics of all sorts throughout human history, but also to measure with greater sympathy the similarities and differences among the classical traditions that have been attested. The sort of comparative study of classical traditions that I am proposing here faces enormous challenges, to be sure. The most obvious one is posed by the sheer number of languages involved and the complexity of the historical knowledge that is presupposed. No one person could possibly be expert in all the traditions that would have to be studied within the terms of such a project. Certainly, I myself know only the barest smatterings of some of the pertinent non-European languages. And at my age, I am not likely to learn much more than that, though that will not stop me from trying. But on the other hand, the fact that such a project is impossible for a single researcher to achieve is not in the least a reason to abandon it. On the contrary, it is a very good reason to imagine it as a project sustained by the systematic collaboration of groups of researchers. After all, it is only in the humanities that we have learned to become familiar with the idea of the solitary individual researcher working alone in his or her library or archive. In most other fields, it is only teams of researchers that do real science. In the natural sciences, for example, the only researchers who work alone are the ones whom no one else wants to work with. And in recent years, the private foundations and public administrations that provide financial support for scientific research in Europe and throughout the world have increasingly preferred, for reasons of blinkered administrative rationality and ignorance of the differences between the humanities and the sciences, to insist that humanities research projects too, like those of the natural sciences, must involve many scholars from many different disciplines. A number of contemporary humanistic scholars have complained about these constraints, and not without reason. But out of this necessity, we can make a virtue. For it happens that serious comparative research on classical traditions cannot be done well in any other way than interdisciplinarily. The crucial prerequisite for progress in these questions is the intense cooperation among a number of scholars who possess, each one, a high degree of competence in one of the cultural fields evolved, but who share with one another basic theoretical questions, a curiosity about other fields, a sense of the limitations of their own field, and above all, mutual respect for the professional expertise of all of the other members of the team and for the dignity of their subjects. All of the factors that I have indicated mean that this is the likely shape of the research of the future. But this will only come about in the future if someone makes a start in the present. And this lecture of mine is intended as one such start. I have chosen, as a Western student of ancient Greek literature, to speak to you not about the Greek classical tradition that I know something about, but about the Chinese one, as I understand it. Let me emphasize that I do not know Chinese, except for the ability to recognize a couple of dozen written characters and to say ni hao and xie xie.
Xie xie.
And that I have never studied Chinese literature and history professionally. I cannot offer you an expert sinologist's view of the Chinese classical tradition. If that is what you came here for, this would be a good moment for you to get up and walk out. For there are thousands of professional sinologists who could give you a more expert account of this topic than I could. Indeed, some of them are sitting right here. Instead, all I can show you is how I, as a Western student of ancient Greece, look at the Chinese classical tradition. That is, I can indicate what are those features of the Chinese tradition that strike me, who have spent my life as a student of the ancient Greek one, as being particularly odd or noteworthy or different in interesting ways from what I would have expected to find on the basis of my experience of the Greek classical tradition. Perhaps my view from abroad will make certain aspects of the Chinese tradition appear in a fresh light. Even the most familiar sights can look suddenly rather odd when we learn to see them with foreign eyes. And in any event, my remarks about the Chinese tradition should make certain aspects of the Greek one seem more puzzling to you, as they now seem more puzzling to me. So I offer my lecture in part as an expression of my gratitude to the sinologists and other Chinese friends who have accompanied my first faltering steps on the path of illumination, in part as an expression of my admiration for the Chinese achievement and for those of the other cultures that I do not discuss today, and in part as an invitation to some as yet unknown Chinese student of ancient Greece to do the same thing for the ancient Greek tradition as I am trying to do today for the ancient Chinese one. That is, to denaturalize it by viewing it with friendly eyes from afar. We might think of today's lecture as a first service in an imaginary game of scholarly ping pong against a friendly but extremely expert Chinese colleague. How will she answer my serve? And what will her own service be like? Or you might think of it as the first part of a cultural round-trip voyage from Athens to China today, and then back again. Why have I chosen to speak to you today about the Chinese classical tradition? All the members of the group of 20 or so classical traditions that are attested throughout the world are worth studying, individually and comparatively. But among them, the Greek and the Chinese stand out as being two of the ones that have flourished the most. The individual significance of these two traditions in particular can easily be measured in terms of a number of criteria. Their continuity and longevity, they have lasted, each of them, 2.5 millennia, virtually without interruption. Their influence on other cultures. The Greek tradition has profoundly shaped such other traditions as the Latin and Arabic ones, and through these, further cultures throughout the world, while the Chinese tradition has deeply affected cultures throughout Asia. The richness, complexity, and sheer number, both of the classic texts that stand at their beginning and of the works of scholarship on them that structure their later development. Thus, it is particularly worth studying these two traditions comparatively, because not only their similarities, but also their differences can tell us much about what makes a classical tradition. Moreover, there seems to have been a relatively high degree of independence and a general lack of connection between these two traditions for most of their history. Even if recent research has begun to suggest that there were, in fact, more frequent and earlier cultural contacts, for example, along the Silk Road or via Gandhara, than was earlier thought to have been the case, nonetheless, such contexts that have been suggested seem, so far at least, to have been sporadic and limited in effect. If we find striking similarities between two classical traditions that are linked by profound causal connections, for example, the Greek and the Latin or Arabic, this need not surprise us, and it can be dismissed as the mere result of massive influence. But if the two classical traditions between which we discover such similarities are instead largely independent of one another, as the Greek and the Chinese seem to have been, then it seems likelier that these are to be explained as basic features of classical traditions in general, and not as an inheritance from any one classical tradition in particular. Of course, such an explanation will need to be tested and refined by further comparison with still other classical traditions, for example, with the Mayan, which seems to have developed entirely on its own without any connection whatsoever with any European or Asian tradition. Let us begin with the similarities between the Chinese and Greek classical traditions, for these are indeed substantial and can suggest to us fundamental features that may be at work in other such traditions as well. First, both traditions are centered on a relatively small number of texts that tend to be of a predominantly literary, historical, or philosophical character, though they also include treatises on scientific topics, especially cosmology, medicine, and mathematics. The matters that these texts discuss are ones of enduring significance. Often they have a conspicuous pedagogical aspect, but they tend to refrain from giving simple answers to easy questions. And if it is human actions that they present for our consideration, they often focus on unsolvable dilemmas, for the most part moral ones, ones for which there is no correct answer, evasion is not on the cards, and a satisfactory outcome is at least difficult, if not impossible, to attain, and will probably end up entailing sorrow. In both of these traditions, there is often a religious dimension to these foundational texts, but neither one is centered upon a definitive sacred scripture upon which an established religion is based, as some other classical traditions are. Second, these texts are very ancient. They go back to the first millennium BCE. In both of their cultures, these texts are among the very earliest ones preserved, these texts are among the very earliest preserved substantial ones. Not because in those ancient times people were smarter than they are now, though both traditions often claim that this was the case, but because these texts were already considered to be so significant that they were preserved in writing at a time when this was not easy, inexpensive, or self-evident. Third, the fact that they are written indicates the high privilege accorded by both cultures to writing. The writing practices whose traces we can perceive were surrounded by a penumbra of oral activities which impacted and supported the writings in many ways, but are preserved for us only indirectly or anecdotally. Written texts must be copied, and for most of human history, this could only be done by hand. The result was the invention of classes of writing experts, from the humblest copyists and scribes to the most exalted philologists and scholars, who copied the texts, proofread them, corrected them, and annotated them. Fourth, these practices were only possible on the basis of highly specific training and educational systems that were so effective that they secured the acculturation of each new cadre of experts in a virtually unbroken succession of generations for 2,500 years. Fifth, the multiplication of written texts led to their collection and storage in institutions designed for this purpose, libraries and archives, accompanied by further classes of experts who were trained in organizing, accessing, protecting, and preserving these materials. Sixth, The complexity and ambiguity of the founding texts, combined with the historical distance between author and reader that increased with every year, and the attendant loss of historical knowledge, created a need for commentaries and other forms of scholarly literature that could explain the difficulties of all sorts that would otherwise have interfered with the text's cultural mission. Scholars could become celebrated as individuals, but they also formed multiple intergenerational intellectual genealogies and communities that could last for centuries because they cohered internally through shared assumptions and tastes, and above all, through their opposition to other competing lineages. Seventh, the practice of exegesis was accompanied by theoretical reflection on the hermeneutic principles involved, in such a way that the concrete interpretation of texts and abstract philosophical speculation could support each other reciprocally, and indeed even blend into one another. In particular, long-lasting and inconclusive disputes were waged between those scholars who suggested that the texts meant exactly what they seemed to be saying, let us call them literalists, and those who claimed instead that their real meaning was at great variance from what appeared on their surface, but violated such canons as those of propriety, plausibility, and religion. These can be called allegorists, but only if we take the term very broadly. And eighth, and finally, the prestige of the founding text could be used not only to legitimate a large variety of social, political, religious, and other institutions, but also permitted those who were educated in them to quote them and allude to them in order to demonstrate to their peers their own high degree of cultivation, and by implication, their wealth, prestige, and power. Thus, these two classical traditions acted not only as integrative factors to give to all the members of their respective societies models for emulation and admiration that they could all believe in, but also as differentiating mechanisms that established unbridgeable hierarchies regulated by unequal degrees of access to the cultural riches they contained, preserved, and concealed. Doubtless, there are other important similarities which could be brought to light by a deeper and more expert comparative study of the Chinese and Greek classical traditions. But these few points are perhaps already enough to indicate how much these two particular traditions have in common, and to suggest that the general concept of a classical tradition is sufficiently definable and detailed enough. But precisely these similarities serve also to bring into sharper focus the striking differences between these two traditions. These differences can give us a sense not only for the ways in which different historical, linguistic, cultural, and social circumstances can generate diverse inflections of the basic model, but also the degree to which that model is flexible and allows for considerable diversity, but within limits. On the basis of my limited knowledge, but my unlimited curiosity, I would suggest provisionally that there are at least six fundamental differences between the Greek and the Chinese classical traditions. So when I say sixth, you'll know that we're near the end. The first one may seem like a small philological point, but it has far-reaching consequences. It is this. In Chinese, there is a word for classic, but in ancient Greek, there is not. It is an astonishing fact that the Greek classical tradition does not know of a term for classical. In Chinese, a classical text is called jing. This is both a way of referring to the genre of classical texts and also to individual classical texts as being classical. And it also appears as part of the title of some of them. For example, the Shi Jing is the classic of poetry, the Yu Jing is the classic of changes, the Shu Jing is the classic of documents, and so forth. Etymologically, the term jing apparently derives from the practice of weaving. It designates the warp, that is, the vertical threads that are tied to a supporting beam and between which the horizontal threads are interwoven in order to produce a textile. The idea seems to be that the classic jing guarantees the general structure and solidity of a successful product, but that the specific features, its pattern and coloring, will depend upon an individual's choices and skill, insofar as he allows himself to be guided by the Jing. There is no corresponding term for a classic in pre-Christian ancient Greek. The verb enkrino means to choose to include someone or something in some group, for example, in a club or in an athletic competition. And the passive participles enkrithes and enkekrimenos can designate someone who has been chosen for inclusion in that group. So these terms could have been used to indicate the inclusion of some text or author among the group of classics. But as far as I know, they are never used in that way except by Christian authors, who usually refer thereby to the canonical writings of the Christian Bible and other ecclesiastical authorities. That is, this usage presupposes the Christian notion of a canon of writings that are accepted for doctrinal reasons as being legitimate. The term canon does come from a Greek word, kanon, which originally refers to any straight rod or bar, and eventually comes to mean a standard of correctness which should be applied to various kinds of actions and products in order to guarantee their correctness. It is perhaps nothing more than a coincidence that already in Homer, the word kanon can designate the weaver's rod from which the threads of the warp are hung. But kanon never refers in non-Christian ancient Greek to individual classical texts or authors or the group of them as being classical. It is only among Christian writers that it designates the narrowly defined group of sacred writings from which alone human salvation can derive. The term classical or classic derives from the Latin word classicus, which indicates someone belonging to one of the five tax brackets or classes of the Roman populace, and then in particular, someone belonging to the wealthiest category. It is applied to authors in only a single passage in all of classical Latin, cited by the late grammarian Aulus Gellius in a deliberately witty and metaphorical phrase in which the classicus scriptor is opposed to the proletarius one. So evidently, a classical tradition can do without a term for classical. A second difference, there's six, a second difference is that the Chinese classical texts form a distinctly identified and finite set of writings. The six arts, liu yi, namely poetry, shi, changes, yi, documents, shu, which we already met earlier, to which must be added the springs and autumns, chunqiu, the music, yue, and the rituals, li, had been a loose repertory of practices and discourses without strictly defined borders. But they came to be redefined at the latest during the Han Dynasty as a clearly defined system of five written treatises, the five classics, omitting the music. Even when the number of classics was increased after the Han Dynasty, from 5 to 7 to 9 to 10, 11 and 12, and finally to 13, including the three hermeneutic traditions for the Chunqiu, all three of which came to be considered as classics in their own right, what is remarkable from the Greek point of view about this group is first of all that it is so clearly defined, and second, that it is so small. The Greek classics are a much larger and nebulous group, constantly shifting depending upon the tastes and needs of the person looking at them. No one would doubt that Homer is a classic, and Sophocles, Herodotus, and Plato. But what about all of the writings attributed to these four authors? Are they all equally classical? And what about all the other ancient writers of epic, tragedy, history, and philosophy? Are they classical too? The very questions seem absurd. In the Greek classical tradition, there are classical texts and authors, and doubtless all of ancient Greek literature is classical in some sense too, but there is nothing in Greek like a standard list of the five or six classics. The Chinese set of classics, despite their heterogeneity with regard to modes of exegesis, textual stability, historical reference, and reliability, obviously form a kind of syllabus for the purposes of instruction, in basic subject matters that are considered to be useful for people to know. That is, a systematic choice of topics and texts has been made with a view to their usefulness for a clearly defined pedagogical program. And that choice has remained valid over the course of many centuries. Doubtless, this is closely connected to the state examination system, which is one of the hallmarks of the Chinese classical tradition and to which nothing in the Greek classical tradition corresponds. I shall return to this issue towards the end of my remarks. Third, the five or six Chinese classics are all basically anthologies derived from earlier writings which must have circulated orally and in writing in more or less similar form for a very long time, probably for centuries, before they were fixed in terms of their number, extent, text, and sequence in the form in which they are transmitted to us. The individual texts contained in the Chinese classic treatises are excerpts or fragments of earlier oral or written texts, which have been preserved by having become embedded in these treatises. The versions on bamboo slips that have been discovered in recent archaeological excavations are almost always rather different from the ones contained in the transmitted classics. Very often, there is nothing at all to be found corresponding to them in the classic texts at all. We can well understand that the Chinese classical tradition is haunted by a fear of the confusion that uncontrolled proliferation might lead to, and retains a memory, doubtless heavily fictionalized, of the processes of radical selection and exclusion that resulted in the existing classics. Thus, Confucius himself is said in one report to have chosen out of what were originally about 3,000 poems in an earlier collection, the 300 that, according to him, were most in conformity with ritual propriety, and these then made up the 305 texts of the extant Shijing. There is nothing at all like any of this in the Greek classical tradition. A few anthologies of short poems in various meters are indeed transmitted from earlier and later antiquity. But these are exceptions. Most of the ancient Greek texts that have survived through medieval transmission were attributed by the Greeks from the very beginning to individual authors and were intended to be transmitted as complete wholes, though of course the accidents of time have meant that many have reached us as incomplete fragments. The Greek classical tradition is haunted not by the specter of uncontrolled proliferation, but by the anxiety of irremediable loss. Scholars try their best to gather all the manuscripts and information they can, lest anything be lost to posterity. The result is that the Greek classical tradition is obsessed by the image it creates of the highly individualized personalities and biographies of the earliest Greek classical authors. Such biographies are doubtless largely fictive and tell us not what the lives of the original authors were like in reality, but how later readers imagine them. So too, portrait busts of Greek authors were created already starting in the 6th century BCE, and for the most part represent not what those authors really looked like, but what later readers supposed, on the basis of their writings, that they must have looked like. As far as I know, the Chinese classical tradition never invented any biographies or portraits of the ultimate authors who originally composed the writings enshrined in their classics. It was not until the Han Dynasty that the Chinese tradition did develop a set of authors for their classics. What happened was that Confucius received a biography written by Sima Qian and came to be related to all five of the classics, though in the very different roles of author, compiler, editor, or commentator. And that the treatise that later came to be called the Yijing became attributed either to the Duke of Zhou or to King Wen, the Zhou founder. The fact that these attributions were surely all fictional is less important in this context than the fact that they were made centuries later and did not accompany the texts from the beginning. Fourth, until the recent archaeological discoveries, all the manuscripts and printed editions of the Chinese classics since about the 3rd century CE have always contained not only the original texts, but also commentaries on them. The same editorial gesture that selected only certain texts for preservation and ordered them in a specific sequence also made sure that the meanings of these texts would be stabilized by accompanying them with authoritative exegeses that explained how the reader was supposed to understand them. Sometimes these exegeses can strike the outside reader as rather strange. A poem which seems to tell of a woman longing for her lover is explained as really being about the city's desire for its ruler. Often the commentaries seem to overemphasize moralistic elements that are already present in the text they are explaining, or even to introduce such elements into the text in the first place. In a recently discovered text held in the Shanghai Museum and entitled by its editors Confucius's Discussion of the Poetry, Confucius himself is said to state, "The poem Guan Zhu uses the expression of sexual allure to illustrate ritual propriety." Such moralistic diffusing of the anarchic potential of literary texts is surely to be understood within the context of the pedagogical function ascribed to the Chinese classics and of its millennial examination system. And it is very easy to find analogous moralizations and allegorizations in the Greek classical tradition as well. But what is strikingly different about the latter in this perspective is that there is a very clear separation between the majority of Greek manuscripts on the one hand that only contain the classic texts themselves, which are found very frequently and begin quite early on papyri in the 4th and 3rd centuries BCE and continue until the Renaissance, and the minority of Greek manuscripts on the other hand that contain either only commentaries or else commentaries together with the texts, which are found less often and begin much later. This means that the Greek classical tradition permits its adherents to have a seemingly direct and unmediated access to the classic texts themselves, while the Chinese classical tradition permits its users to obtain access to its texts only through the mediation of authoritative commentaries. So too, all of the classics were thought to exist during the Han Dynasty in various different school versions, each with a somewhat different text and a radically different oral or written commentary. After the Han Dynasty, most of these competing traditions gradually disappear until, in the 7th century under the Tang Empire, the court orders that a new compilation of the 5 classics be produced, entitled The Correct or Corrected Meaning of the 5 Classics. The one version of each classic that was chosen at this time was the one that came to be transmitted through the later tradition as the only canonical one. Fifth. There is a striking difference between these true traditions that becomes apparent when we consider the question of textual variants. Whenever texts are copied by hand, errors are made. The more they are copied, the more the errors. So the fact of textual variance is inevitable and universal. But the value and attention accorded to textual variants can differ widely from one culture to another. In the case of the Greek and Chinese traditions, these differences were determined in large part by the basic nature of the two languages involved, the Greek alphabetic script versus the Chinese logographic. Ancient Greek scholars were obsessed by the attempt to identify and correct every single textual error they could find. They seem to have supposed that only one variant could be correct, that there were also mistakes to be rectified in cases in which the manuscripts did not diverge, and that the purity of the originals would be obscured by any degree of contamination by textual mistakes. In the Chinese tradition, by contrast, each school version had its own text, which it understood differently from that of other school versions, and the commentary for that version defended the correctness of its own text against the variants to be found in other competing and putatively inferior versions. The very way in which the Chinese non-alphabetic writing system represented the Chinese language meant that homophonic and other kinds of variants were far more complicated and occurred far more frequently than could possibly have happened in the Greek tradition. The Chinese seem to have had no difficulty in accepting the notion that each classic could exist in very different versions and commentary traditions, each one sponsored and protected by different schools. Indeed, in the Han Imperial Academy, each version had its own official professorship. For the Greeks, this would have been the stuff of nightmares. Sixth, and finally, the Chinese classical tradition recognizes not only classical texts and commentaries on them, but also accords classic status to some commentaries as well, and has devised a further genre of scholarly literature, the sub-commentary, which is a commentary on a classical commentary on a classical text. The difference between text and commentary is immediately obvious when we look at a Chinese manuscript or printed edition. For the text is written in large characters that fill a column, while the commentary is written in much smaller characters that fill two columns within the same space as the single column of the commented text. In the case of a sub-commentary, the commentary itself is written in the large characters usually reserved for the classic text, and the smaller characters are assigned to the sub-commentary. Nothing could express more clearly the classic status that is being assigned to the commentary. In ancient Greece, matters are entirely different. Greek commentators always comment on the base text, never on other commentaries. They can occasionally quote other commentaries in order to agree, or more often to disagree with them, and they sometimes write treatises about earlier scholarship. But I do not know of a single instance from ancient Greece of a commentator who wrote a sub-commentary on someone else's commentary. Ancient Greek scholars seem to have had no difficulty attaching their own name to the celebrated name of a classic author, but they seem to have felt far too proud to stoop to writing a sub-commentary on some other scholar's commentary. It is not until Christianity and the Byzantine period that we start to find sub-commentaries in Greek. I will add, as a parenthetical hypothesis, that I have the impression that sub-commentaries have been much more widespread in classical traditions throughout the world than one would guess if one only considered the Greek model. We might summarize all these differences in the following way. All classical traditions define as classical the classical texts they curate, but the Chinese tradition seems to do so in a far more obvious and radical way, not only defining its texts as classical, but also creating them as such in the first place. The Greek classical tradition seems to have inherited remarkable texts and then gradually to have done what it could to preserve and understand them in the most authentic form possible. The Chinese classical tradition made a narrow selection out of the texts it encountered and assembled these into collections whose interpretations it prescribed. To put the difference in a nutshell, there is no Homer in China and there is no Confucius in Greece. Homer was taken by the Greeks to be the ultimate source of their civilization, a real person who had once lived and who had bestowed upon them most of what was valuable in their culture. Greek scholarship was posterior and secondary. Confucius is for the Chinese a classic author, but from the point of view of the Chinese classic tradition, he is also at least as important in his role as the putative compiler and editor of the Chinese classics. Confucius is not the most ancient literary figure for whom fictional biographies exist, but he was among the very first to receive a dedicated biography in Sima Qian's Records of the Historian from the late 2nd century BCE. He was worshipped with sacrifices in temples for millennia throughout China as the principal ancestor of Chinese culture as a whole, and his fictive portraits show him sometimes as a wandering sage, sometimes as a scholar in a library. Yet he is not considered to be himself the ultimate and primary source of most of the texts he is thought to have gathered and transmitted. The sources of those Chinese texts are anonymous. None of them is celebrated in the way that Homer is in the Greek tradition. In that Greek tradition, the figures that would correspond to Confucius's editorial achievements would be the great Alexandrian philologists of the 4th and 3rd centuries BCE, like Callimachus and Aristophanes of Byzantium and Aristarchus. But these scholars are known and respected only by modern philologists. No one reveres them in the way that the Chinese revere Confucius. There may well be other important differences between the Chinese and Greek classical traditions than these, and the ones that I have indicated may well be based more upon my ignorance or provinciality than upon the facts of the matter. I look forward to being corrected by my sinological friends and colleagues, and for that matter, by my Hellenist ones. But if there is something to these points, then it is incumbent upon us to try to explain them. And here the crucial difference seems to me the centrality and continuity of the Chinese state on the one hand versus the fragmentation and discontinuity of Greece on the other. In China, emperors and dynasties came and went with astonishing frequency, but they were like the foam on the ocean's surface, which catches the light and dazzles our eyes, but is subject to constant change. Below that level, the Chinese state seems to have gone on and on with massive and imperturbable regularity for many centuries, with its enormous bureaucracy, its institutions of administrative control and reporting, and its army of countless bureaucrats. The supply of these functionaries was renewed in every generation by those successful candidates out of the millions of unsuccessful ones who passed the state examinations in which their knowledge of the Chinese classics and of the authorized interpretation of them was tested year after year, generation after generation, century after century. Of course, there were developments and reforms and disputes within the Chinese classic tradition too, but these seem to have had little effect upon the basic stability of the system for millennia. If the Chinese classic tradition worked from the top down, the Greek classic tradition seemed to have worked from the bottom up. For most of their history, the Greeks never managed to create a single strong central state. Each city-state, or later each Hellenistic kingdom, had its own administration and public, or more usually private, educational system. What unified Greek culture was not a state examination system, but the authority of Homer and of the other ancient Greek classic texts. It was only in the Middle Ages, in Byzantium, that the Greek classical tradition came to know anything at all like the Chinese model, a sequence of dynasties, each comprising a succession of single monarchies, equipped with a large bureaucracy and an extensive educational and examination system. But even here, the Byzantine version was less monumental, less systematic, and less long-lasting than the Chinese one. And besides, the Byzantines saw themselves not as Greeks, but as Romans. This, then, is the way that I, as a Western student of ancient Greek, look at the Chinese classical tradition. In the past, comparative studies tended to be few and sporadic, and they were often rejected as being superficial and amateurish. I hope that today's lecture will be seen in retrospect not only as one of the last in that past series, but also as one of the first in a new series, which will aim to be far more even-handed and expert than past attempts sometimes were. When I compare the two traditions, what I see makes the Chinese tradition seem rather strange, but it makes the Greek tradition, which I had thought seemed so familiar, become instead much stranger. That is the reason for doing a round trip from Athens to China and back. One travels not only to familiarize oneself with what is foreign, but also to defamiliarize oneself with what had seemed natural. To refer to the analogy of table tennis, this lecture was my attempt to understand China. Ping. Now I hope that some Chinese student of ancient Greece will answer by offering his attempt to understand Greece, and that will be Pong. Grazie mille. Vi chiedo scusa, è stato un pochino troppo lungo, però l'argomento è vasto.
Grazie moltissime, Glenn, per questa ricca e inspiring lecture, really inspiring lecture. I think that you gave us stimuli for the rethinking the study of the classics in this university. We don't give this opportunity to our students. Actually, they study either Greek, Latin, or Chinese, or other languages, other cultures, classics, and I think we should do more to give this opportunity to the students. See my colleague there who agree on this. We are trying, actually, to organize seminars and lectures and one summer schools, actually, as I told you yesterday, for our students, inviting Chinese scholars in Greek and Latin and Western scholars in Chinese, sinologists. And I hope we will be able to organize this next week, and you are welcome, of course, to join us. But I would like to give the floor to the students, to Willy, but especially to the students, and I hope they can raise some questions or comments. Please. Don't be shy.
Coraggio. Abbaio, ma non mordo.
Per rompere your lecture was about the state of art of classical studies in the so-called West and in China, and it is true that China is very much interested in classical studies since the 19th, maybe, and there are many students in classes of Greek and Latin now, because they are interested in our civilization more than we are towards China. And if you think that these things, which are called the ranking societies, like US, they have a category in the classics, and we have a very high score in the classics. Our university has acquired a very high score. But for them, classics is just Latin and Greek, and there are no other classics in the world. So there is much work to do. And one thing I wanted to ask you, how do you see the cooperation between scholars in Western classics and Asian or Chinese classics in the future?
Thank you, Tiziana. Should I speak in English or Italian?
If you prefer Italian, so maybe they feel more at ease.
Facciamo in italiano? Okay. È la vostra scelta.
È perfetto in italiano.
Quando ho cominciato negli anni 90 e primo a cercare a creare gruppi di filologi in diverse tradizioni che potevano lavorare insieme sulle tradizioni classiche, non era molto facile. In quel periodo i filologi greci e latini dell'Occidente non avevano nessun interesse in altre culture e pensavano che quello che facevano era così importante e interessante che comparazione non interessava loro. Mentre i cinesi negli anni 80 e primi anni 90 non avevano nessun interesse alle tradizioni classiche occidentali, in parte perché avevano ancora poco interesse alle proprie tradizioni classiche. Perché con la rivoluzione culturale, Confucius e tutto il passato era stato soppresso. Gli eruditi erano mandati ai campi di riso, eccetera. Questo si è cambiato in questi anni sui due lati. Da un lato, i filologi classici nell'Occidente sono entrati in crisi e hanno visto che il mondo non era più perfetto e non tutti erano interessati a quello che facevano e hanno cominciato ad ascoltare altri. Mentre in Cina, dagli anni 90 in poi, gli scavi archeologici, legali e illegali, hanno portato alla luce tutti questi testi su bambù e altri reperti archeologici, grandi vasi di bronzo con iscrizioni, altre cose, anche seta, che davano a loro un passato diverso di quello che pensavano di avere. La rivoluzione culturale aveva tagliato la catena di generazione dei eruditi che generazione dopo generazione avevano studiato il passato. I cinesi si trovavano all'improvviso con tutto questo passato senza però lo stesso grado di competenze esperte che avrebbero voluto avere per capirli. E hanno cominciato a vedere l'Occidente dove c'era questa tradizione filologica classica, una tradizione per cui l'Occidente si interessava sempre meno, ma che per i cinesi era diventato all'improvviso molto interessante. Il risultato è che hanno cominciato a invitare persone come me a venire in Cina per parlare della tradizione classica occidentale, e hanno cominciato a mandare studenti cinesi all'Occidente per studiare greco-latino. Io ho fatto un seminario, un corso per dottorandi a Chicago nell'inverno scorso su Sofocle. E in questo corso c'erano 18 studenti, tra cui 6 cinesi. Cinesi o in Cina, o in Europa, o in America, ma persone che avevano cominciato in Cina. E alcuni di questi erano i migliori del gruppo. Quando i cinesi hanno cominciato a venire 20 anni fa nell'Occidente, spesso avevano una grande competenza linguistica, però nessuna idea della realtà storica della Grecia o di Roma. Per loro era come un altro pianeta. Ma nel frattempo hanno imparato anche quello. E il risultato è che, in effetti, ci sono tanti bravi studenti cinesi di greco-latino. Molti studiano qui, in Europa. Molti restano. Se vogliono tornare, trovano subito un posto di lavoro. E questo è un altro motivo per loro di studiare. Adesso sono in contatto, in scambio, con varie istituzioni, università in Cina, e con un numero impressionante di professori e di studenti cinesi, e spero che gli scambi tra Cina e l'Occidente, nonostante i problemi politici e economici e epidemiologici, continueranno e si potenzieranno. Credo che Venezia è un luogo importante per questo nei prossimi anni. Ecco, hai rotto il ghiaccio.
Ho rotto il ghiaccio.
I think it's the fourth difference that you mentioned, where you mentioned the city that is in love with its ruler, and that it, in fact, is a story that looks to us like a love story. Or it reminded me of the Song of Songs. Did you think of that? That is read throughout the Middle Ages as the love of the church for Christ, I think, and when we read it today, it seems absolutely very similar to what the example that you gave. It looks like a rather erotic story, and it's read in this way. So perhaps we could move it on to the other category. What do you think?
Thank you. It's a wonderful observation. The poem that I was referring to in the Shi Jing, if you just read the poem, you would never think that this has a political aspect. And I think that it has this political aspect because the Maoist edition and commentary, which is heavily Confucian, justified the inclusion of this poem by saying that it was really politically, morally uplifting. The case of the Song of Songs is a fascinating one. The remarkable thing is that the Song of Songs is included in the Hebrew Bible and in the Christian Bible because it doesn't seem to fit with some of the other ones. It's obvious, I think, that there would be pressure on the interpretation of the Song of Songs to make it fit. And the way to do that was by exactly the kind of allegory that you were talking about. But in the case of the Song of Songs, it's even more complicated than that, because it forms part of Jewish religion, as expressed in the Hebrew Bible, that God feels towards the Jewish people the way a jealous husband feels. And when the Jewish people betray God by worshiping other gods, he regards them as an unfaithful wife. And that means that religion, the language of, and becomes angry, it becomes furious and jealous. Your God is a jealous God. And jealous in that sense is also sexually jealous. So that means that the language of eroticism and sexuality was already used in Judaism for theological and religious issues. And I think that that was part of what made it even possible to include the Song of Songs in the Bible in the first place. And it meant then that when the commentators said, well, this is really about the relation between God and his church, or God and his people, that there was there were presuppositions for that. Okay, thank you.
Enrico. Silvio.
Grazie, io ringrazio il professor Most per la sua lecture e vorrei chiederle se ritiene plausibile che ci possa essere un'ulteriore specifica riguardo a cosa rende classico un classico, no? Se penso alla tradizione cinese, mi viene istintivo soffermarmi su un aspetto particolare, cioè ci sono vari testi che sono naturalmente creati sulla base di citazioni dei classici. Cioè, può essere considerato questo un aspetto in qualche modo comune o difforme rispetto alla tradizione greca, in modo tale da considerare un classico un testo o più testi che contribuiscono a creare altri testi, che ovviamente non fanno parte della tradizione strettamente esegetica, ma in qualche modo offrono uno spazio, diciamo, di esplosione, di deflagrazione di significato, dando luogo ad altri testi, creando altri testi. Volevo poi sottoporre all'attenzione, come dire, un criterio di per sé banale, diciamo, per definire un classico, soprattutto in Cina. Cioè, un classico a me sembra un testo che sostanzialmente vanta almeno un commentario. È il commentario che fa classico, che rende classico il classico. E questo criterio, secondo me, è molto utile per due motivi. Da una parte ci permette di illuminare, diciamo così, altre dimensioni extra ru, extra confuciane, che sono pervase da una loro classicità e da una loro canonicità. In sostanza i Jin non appartengono solo alla tradizione dei Ru, dei Confuciani, ma ci sono tanti altri Jin, no? E poi anche all'interno della dimensione Ru, questo criterio classico, canone e commentario ci permette anche di vedere oltre quel limite dei 5-6 classici, perché lei menzionava, e sono stato molto colpito da questa sua competenza anche riguardo agli ultimi ritrovamenti archeologici. Cioè, c'è un testo Ru, palesemente Ru, che in epoca Han, presumibilmente prima che l'imperatore Wu definisse cosa dovesse entrare o meno nel novero dei classici, c'era un testo che era sfuggito poi alla classificazione, probabilmente volontariamente, dei censori Han, che è stato ritrovato nel 1973, poi con un secondo testimone nel 1993, quindi a distanza di 20 anni, che già in epoca Han vantava un suo commentario, del quale però dagli Han in poi si è perso traccia. Quindi probabilmente anche pensare questo rapporto strettissimo canone-commentario come una possibilità di andare oltre questo set di 5-6 classici che tradizionalmente sembrano esaurire completamente quello che è lo spazio ermeneutico Ru, ma che in realtà probabilmente prevedeva all'epoca qualcosa di molto più ampio e più esteso. Grazie.
La ringrazio io. Divido le sue osservazioni, che sono molto stimolanti e utili, in due parti. Il primo riguarda il fatto che il testo classico genera nuovi testi nella forma di citazione, nuovi testi che sono composti interamente di citazione. Questo è un fatto interessantissimo che però vale non solo per Cina, ma anche per Grecia e per la letteratura latina. C'è il genere letterario del centone. Ci sono testi greci che sono completamente composti di citazioni di Omero, e ci sono testi latini che sono completamente composti di citazioni di Virgilio. In greco c'è Christus Patiens, in latino c'è Ausonio, e poi ci sono anche altri, c'è una Medea, ci sono vari altri. Questo mi sembra un fatto interessantissimo, e poi lo inserirei nella mia discussione, e lo inserirò nella mia discussione, al punto in cui parlo delle citazioni. Qui abbiamo non persone colte che fanno citazioni tattiche, ma invece autori che fanno citazioni sistematiche, e sono in tutte e due le tradizioni. L'altro sul rapporto tra, sul fatto che è il commento che definisce un testo come classico, è una specificazione di quello che io penso e ho suggerito, che è la tradizione classica che crea il testo classico. Però, e sono anche d'accordissimo che ci sono stati testi classici in Cina, per esempio, che sono stati commentati, che poi sono spariti. E anche i commenti classici che ricevono un sub-commentary sono anche in questo senso testi classici. Però in Grecia non c'è niente come questo. Ci sono testi classici che hanno ricevuto tanti commenti già nell'antichità, soprattutto i testi, diciamo, poetici, Omero, Esiodo, i lirici, i testi tragici e comici, però testi che valgono come classici che non hanno mai ricevuto un commento nell'antichità. Il problema è che in Grecia il concetto di classico è più fluido e meno dogmatico, diciamo. In Cina sono d'accordissimo, e sicuramente anche in altre tradizioni classiche, che la mera esistenza di un commento basta per definire un testo come il testo commentato come classico. Ma in Grecia e in Roma è più difficile creare questo legame così forte. Non so se ho risposto. Grazie mille.
Se posso aggiungere qualcosa, mi ha molto colpito quello che hai detto sul processo bottom-up rispetto a top-down, che è appunto una caratteristica anche contemporanea cinese. Allora, tranne il periodo, il XX secolo, in cui appunto hanno abolito i classici in Cina, quindi dal movimento del 4 maggio fino agli anni 90, diciamo, tranne quel periodo, il classico è stato al centro della storia, della politica, della vita cinese fino al XX secolo, e poi ora ripreso in modo molto vigoroso. Quindi questa è anche un'altra grande differenza, che i commentari, come dicevi tu e come diceva anche Attilio, erano dei classici di per sé, perché erano i classici che legittimavano le dinastie, e quindi erano diversi. Ed ecco perché quando i cinesi parlano di trama e ordito per definire il classico, intendono anche la intersezione tra i commentari e il testo. Cioè, a un certo punto, c'è un bellissimo libro di Makeham su questo, il commentario era un classico e non c'era più distinzione tra commentario e classico.
Good morning, professor. First of all, thank you for the lecture. I actually found it eye-opening. My question is about what you said, that we are going towards, we could say, a new comparative studies field about classical traditions and not about the classical tradition. And one of the most striking points you made was actually, at least for me, the fact that we could see and we can see connections between how classical traditions are perceived and how, for example, also for different forms of states can actually develop. So my question is, could we actually go towards a new comparative studies field also concerning the different connection between, for example, political science, political theory, and humanities, trying to get to a new perception of humanities, a new discovery of humanities studies also under that perspective, maybe especially for Westerners that in this period of time are not that keen on trying to study and deepen their interests on humanities. Maybe humanities can actually tell us something about the fragilities of our political models, or for example, the liberal democracy model that this, in this period of time is in a deep crisis, and could actually teach us what we are doing wrong, for example, and why some features of these models are not working. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm moved by your question, and I'm grateful for it. I envy you because you're going to be able to see these developments for the next 60 years. I won't. And I wish that I knew what they will be like in 60 years. Afterwards, you'll come and tell me, wherever we are. I think that you've exactly understood my own sense that philology and literary studies and political studies cannot be entirely separated from one another. Political studies, if they are separated from classical texts, become just sort of quantitative statistics. But if they are involved with classical texts of political thought, then they inevitably raise all the questions of the classical tradition that I was trying to raise. The one thing I would say is that I think that it's better to wait to do comparative studies until one really knows one tradition very well. That there's a danger in comparing things before one knows at all what one is comparing. And that the best comparisons that I have seen work with groups of people who each have a specific competence but are fascinated by the others. So that I would say, if possible, don't do comparison too early, but a lecture like mine and other people, I'm not the only one, and there will be more and more of us, is a good way of raising questions which will help you understand the classical tradition that you study in its bizarreness and in its familiarity. Does that answer your question? Good luck.
Other questions? Could you please introduce yourself?
Thank you for the lecture, first of all. I'm a student of Chinese, and my question is, I think that between the ancient Greek tradition and the Chinese one, both traditions attach much importance to the oral transmission of text. The Greek tradition to the Iliad and Odyssey, and the Chinese one to the Confucian classics. And in fact, the term Jing is the same one that indicates the Buddhist sutras in Indian tradition. So it's another tradition when oral transmission is fundamental. So my question is, are important, the oral transmission is important in both traditions? Which are the dynamics? The dynamics are the same in Chinese and Greek tradition. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a question which fascinates me and which I hope to work on in the coming years. Both traditions, the Greek and the Chinese, seem to me to put a real privilege upon writing. But writing practices are always accompanied by oral ones. For example, I have read a lecture which I wrote, but I read it out loud, and we are now having a conversation. Even in our incredibly writing-oriented world that we live in today, oral practices surround the written text and make it possible. This was much more the case in the past. But both cultures give a real privilege to the fact of writing. In Chinese, the logographic system, in Greek, the Punic characters, which Cadmus was said to have brought to Greece, these are regarded as real revolutionary events in human history and generate all kinds of processes of instruction, of cultural differentiation, of hierarchy, and so forth. It doesn't have to be that way. For example, in Sanskrit, the Sanskrit texts were memorized. They were memorized for tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of verses, backwards and forwards, every 10 verses, every 20 verses. To be able to memorize them was a sign that you were of the right level of instruction and illumination. And if you needed writing, it meant that you were nothing. There, the privilege was given entirely to oral communication and transmission. That's why we have Sanskrit manuscripts only from a very late date, starting around in the second millennium CE, whereas the texts go back much older, and we can't date the texts because they existed in an oral form for so long. So I don't think that writing is necessarily part of the classical tradition, but it can be. There, put Chinese and Greek together, well, Sanskrit is way off in the other direction. In the other direction to that would be Hebrew and Arabic, where the classical tradition is about a sacred scripture, in which is said to have been dictated by God to Moses or to Muhammad. And there, the writing itself has a sacred quality. So there are different degrees of importance of writing and orality. The problem for us, for people like me, is that orality doesn't leave traces in the same way as writing does. The evidence is harder to find. So you have to find it indirectly, or by anecdotes, or by images. It's there, but you have to look for it. I'll go one step further, if I may. I think that there are other classical traditions in the world that I haven't mentioned in this lecture, which are purely oral. For example, in Africa, for example, in Asia. These are ones which I want to know much more about, but it's much harder to find out about them. and in some ways it's not less important. Thank you.
Thank you, Glenn. I think Professor Cingano wants to raise a question.
Just a few words. I didn't want to step in the discussion earlier on. I would say that every sentence in your lecture calls for discussion, and I was particularly stirred by the first part. I mean, you can talk philological matters regarding Greece over lunch or dinner, so I'll leave it for a later discussion. But regarding what you said, I think you touched upon very important political issues regarding national identity when you talk about the fate of classics in the Western world, how to teach it and how much to teach it, to what extent, and who is going to have the privilege or the duty to teach classics. So these are, as I said, political issues which are going to be hotly debated, because they also touch upon the national sense of identity. Are we Italians more entitled to teach classics than the Dutch, who had no Romans and Greeks on their land? Are we supposed to carry on this as a duty? Are we justified in carrying on teaching of classics in a broader way than other countries who had no Greeks and Romans, who are at the border with other civilizations? Well, there's a lot of plenty of questions which you raised, and also which make me a bit uncomfortable about the state of classics in the future.
I will not conceal, thank you, Willie, I will not conceal, and I think I did not conceal, that I am worried about the state of my field in the present, and what I think will be likely to happen in the coming years. A friend of mine who had the kindness to read my paper said that he thought that the first part was a swan song to classics. And I wrote back to him that it wasn't my intention to sing a swan song, but rather to try to find a way to save classics. And that I think that globalizing the idea of the classical tradition might be a way to justify continuing to study it against the people who think that it should not be studied at all. I have been involved, as you certainly have as well, in endless debates about the value of the classics and about racism and sexism and decolonialism and hegemonialism, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. This is my proposal for how to get around such debates and to justify the study of texts and traditions that I love and that I think are worth saving, but which are difficult to justify in the current world unless you expand your vision.
Just a foot. Polemics with the Harvard University Press regarding the article. If you had written a classical tradition on the title, just that, it would have been very enigmatic in a way. So it needed a subtitle, a classical tradition, Greece and Rome. Maybe that would have worked with the publishers.
I tried that too. They just... They didn't like the idea. The funny thing about that book was that the people at Harvard University Press who really wanted to make that book were not the scholarly side, but the business side, because they were sure that if they sold the book cheaply enough, lots and lots of people would buy it, but only if it was called The Classical Tradition. And they seemed to have been right. But I offered to them a classical tradition, Greece and Rome in the world, and so no interest.
Ci sono altre domande? No? So if not, we thank you for this wonderful lecture, and we really hope to have you here again in the future. Thank you so much, Glenn.
My thanks to all of you, the older ones and the younger ones. And I wish you all joy in what you do. And I hope to come back soon and see you again.
I had this participation. You see, the room is full with, and there are people online, also from China. And this testified to importance and to the interest towards the classics and towards you, of course.